Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here with you today, and it's fantastic to see so many of you come out today. This is obviously a topic of conversation that is of great interest to all here. I'd like to thank specifically all of the sponsors that have contributed so generously to this event today, both from Durham Region and right across the GTA. Another example of how important this discussion is, how important and top of mind this topic. My whole council is here today. And you've heard that there is a broad range of politicians right across the political spectrum from all levels of government. That speaks to the commitment and the need and their support for this notion of development in the East GTA. You know, and I know, as politicians, we can't create jobs. That's your job, and you do it extremely well. Our job as politicians is to create an environment in which those jobs can be delivered and grow. And that's the opportunity that is before us. 47 years ago, lands were expropriated in Pickering. For 47 years, there has been a question mark hanging over the East GTA. Now our time is now. Your time is now. It's time for the question mark to be erased, and it's time for growth to go forward. Thank you all very much for being here today, and God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming this afternoon. What I'd like to do is, of course, give you a quick overview, as Jan said, of the Aerotropolis, what it is, but I really want to put it in the context of what is taking place in the greater Toronto region. First of all, in understanding both the region, your current airports, and the future, it's important really to recognize how airports and their roles and functions have changed in the 21st century. 30, 40 years ago, they're primarily transportation infrastructure. Planes landed, took off, passengers, cargo, transit. They've really changed their role. Today, they are regional engines for economic development. That, as you can see on the screen, major magnets in attracting investment. They boost trade substantially, create jobs, increase the competitiveness of the region's firms and places. It's not just a place to take off and land. Toronto Pearson, I think, is a really good example. Most of you are familiar with this, that's why I just have a few statistics. They're responsible directly or indirectly for 332,000 jobs in the Toronto region. US $42 billion of economic output. That's actually revenue that goes into the firms. 13% of the GTA's GDP and 6.3% of Ontario's. I think Jan mentioned Mississauga. The number of businesses that have moved to Mississauga, it's not just those in logistics, but all types of executives and professionals. Over 60 Canadian and international headquarter firms are here, primarily because of the airport. Why is the impact so great? And why have these roles changed? It's about speed, connectivity, time, and optimizing time. Because when I was in my MBA, time was considered a cost. Today, time is a currency. And high-value products and high-value people are tied to this, not just cost, but currency. Examples of high-value products and high-value people who necessarily go by air. You can see them here, the products, aerospace components, biomeds, cross-border e-commerce, fresh food products, medical devices, semiconductors, smartphones, I could go on and on. High value to weight products. Some are even heavy, like jet engines, but the value is so great, it's the ratio of the value to weight that's critical. These products go by air, 70, 80%. High value business people. Corporate executives we see right here in downtown Toronto, auditors, consultants, corporate lawyers, engineers, fashion clothing designers, investment bankers, marketing, media, on and on. Today, if you take lumber, concrete, all the things that move oil products by air, put them in, still 35%, they never go by air, okay? These products, lumber, steel, 35% of the value of global trade moves by air. Of the value, 1% by weight, because the high-value products that move by air. Much higher percentage, about 85%, of high-tech products move around the world by air. Exports of business services, of which Toronto is key. Almost all the international flows of business services, advanced business services, people fly to the destination or bring in their clients. High-value products and high-value people go by air. That's why 30%, 35% of the value of global trade now goes by air. Toronto, which we heard the figure going up to as much as 85 million people, is going to be facing capacity constraints, regionally and certainly with Toronto Pearson, your global hub. And this is going to negatively affect these flows of high-value products and high-value people. A couple of quick statistics here of how rapid Pearson is growing. 2014, 38.6 million. As Jan said, almost 50 million in 2018. The latest master plan indicates that the airport may be able to handle up to 85 million passengers by the mid-2030s. But once you start getting 65, 70, 75, 80, 85 million, certain diseconomies come in and begin to play a role. There are flight delays. The planes are circling longer. There are crowded gate areas. The landside ground congestion getting to the airport. Look at almost all the main arteries during rush hour from the north and the east are jammed. 401, which has the distinction of being recognized as the busiest expressway or freeway in North America between Yonge Street and 427, it's just cramped. The studies done by the Canadian Automobile Association said there's 3.2 million hours lost per year with automobiles tied up. And that affects the quality of life of people that aren't going to the airport. They're caught up in this traffic, too. So you have these diseconomies that are setting in. The airport has some plans, but nonetheless, they will get more and more expensive as you get up to 65, 70, 75 million. This has to be recognized. How can Toronto address these air capacity challenges? Well, one can be, as Jan said, and they're doing it, better utilize the Southern Ontario Airport Network's regional airports, which are now 11, with the addition of SNARIA Chris Hanfield this past January. And it's not an or, but build a major new commercial airport. I didn't say a reliever airport. I didn't say an overflow airport. Build a major new commercial airport to meet future regional air traffic demands and to serve as the dual economic engine with Pearson for this region. Now, Richard Florida will talk about scale effects and activity effects and how you have to be a certain size before really these impacts come in. The utilizing the SOAN, the Southern Ontario Airport Network, absolutely, this has to be done. But there are certain constraints that a number of the airports face. Either they're too far away, 100 kilometers or more. You can't have jets land them. There are certain night curfews. There are a lot of factors that that come into play. Yes, they will continue to be very, very important. The other issue is you have to realize, anyone that studies airline economics, you just can't sprinkle the flights, the airlines, around 11 airports. The airline economics and the airport economics don't work that way. So the strategy that is selected, and it doesn't have to be zero sum, just has to recognize that there are only certain types of returns and benefits that the network can provide, and you have to ask yourself the question, will that be sufficient? I'm not getting a movement on my, here we go. And this gets to the Pickering Airport. What is it going to be? Is it going to be a relatively small reliever airport? I've read about this. I've followed the websites serving primarily general aviation and short-distance regional jet travel that will help capture Pearson's overflows. Or will it be the airport actually was originally envisioned by the federal government when they acquired the Pickering lands? Toronto's second major commercial airport with an integrated outlying aerotropolis. What is an aerotropolis? The best definition is, and the one that I use, is on the top. An aerotropolis is a metropolitan subregion whose business, industry, and tourism clusters are sustained by an airport and its integrated highway, rail, and port infrastructure. An aerotropolis just isn't an airport. It's a multimodal complex that consists of two components. The airport itself and its aeronautical, logistics, and commercial facilities that anchor this multimodal, multifunctional airport city at its core. And then as you go out, outline corridors and clusters of aviation-oriented businesses and industries that feed off of each other and their accessibility to the airport and other key transport and urban nodes. So just as you have Central City and its rings of commuter-heavy suburbs, you have an airport city at the core and these strings and clusters and nodes of airport-linked businesses and industries. This is a compressed version of 12 airport areas I've been studying now for almost 20 years. No one airport area looks exactly like this. These are the major airport areas, but they're all beginning to approach it. I wish I had time to go into the details, but this is a compressed version of 12 aerotropolises that I've been following in their development over the last 18 years. What are the businesses that are located there? I was only able to select some of them because it become too crowded. You have the airport city at the center, just as you have Central City and Metropolis. You have airport city and aerotropolis. You have people-oriented business functions, and you have goods-oriented business functions. Right adjacent to the hotel, the airport hotels, business meeting facilities, car rental, office buildings as you move out, spill over the fence, business parks, corporate headquarters, conference and exhibition, hotel clusters, leisure and entertainment venues, medical and wellness. Also from the goods-oriented, everything from aircraft assembly, repair, cold chain facilities for perishables, food, and medicine, e-commerce exchanges, advanced precision manufacturing, fashion, clothing, accessories, high-value agricultural production, semiconductors, smartphone, ICT assembly, time-critical distribution. You see these all laid out and developing and tied in to the airport. But the aerotropolis just isn't spines and clusters of these time-critical, high-value businesses. The aerotropolis is also a strategy. And that is a successful aerotropolis, and I want you to really think about this, represents a coordinated set of infrastructure, commercial real estate, and government interventions that upgrade the airport region's urban and employment assets, that reduce ground-based transport times and costs, and then expand air route connectivity to attract investment and leverage aviation-enabled trade in goods and services for municipal, provincial, and national competitiveness, job creation, and economic growth. So what are the primary value propositions of a Toronto East Aerotropolis? For firms, it will provide businesses located near or with good transport access to a new Toronto East Airport with speedy connectivity to their suppliers, customers, clients, and enterprise partners nationally and worldwide. For the municipalities and the region, it will leverage the new airport and improve multimodal surface transport connectivity to draw tourists and attract investment in high-end manufacturing, high-value agriculture, and modern business services. Basically, connectivity. It provides connectivity, and today connectivity is competitiveness. Now let me show you a very brief, because I don't have time to go into the detail of what an aerotropolis looks like. This video synthesizes the components of 17 aerotropolises that I've been working with over the last 18 years. No one aerotropolis has all of these, but these are not Buck Rogers ideas. Everything you're going to see in this video actually exists in a few or even more of these aerotropolises. May we show this video, please? This is about creating urban competitiveness. A city made for speed is made for success. It's about the fifth wave of aviation. First wave, seaports; second wave, rivers and canals; third wave, railroads; fourth wave, highways. Now the fifth wave, airports, are anchoring urban development and economic growth. The competitive advantage of any city rests on a well-planned physical and commercial infrastructure. This is the commercial infrastructure, logistics and just-in-time manufacturing, building up around the airport. Free trade zones, reduce taxes, cut red tape, boost exports. E-commerce and distribution, rapid response for customer orders. FlexTech, source, assemble, repair, ship quickly. This is the infrastructure, the commercial infrastructure of the Aerotropolis. Intermodal freight hub brings together air, rail, highways, and ports. Office parks and office corridors to connect air travel intensive executives to their clients and customers. Exhibition and conference centers, trade and knowledge exchange. Hotels, entertainment, and retail clusters that serve not just the long-distance travelers, but the local population. Medical and wellness clusters for medical tourism and healthcare provision. Academic and research clusters for executive education and research. Mixed-use residential areas to house the Aerotropolis workforce. Now you're going to see the Aerotropolis form, beginning right with the center, the airport, which is the multimodal commercial core of the Aerotropolis. The terminal is going to be a different terminal in the 21st century. If I could design a terminal today for an airport, this is how it would look like. It'll be multimodal, multifunctional. It will have all the basic functions you see of a regular terminal today. You're going to Pearson, the R&B, the airline services, but on top of business meetings and support services, flex offices, accommodations, and corporate suites, just like at stadiums. On the airport property, that's inside the fence, office buildings, hotels, retail, and exhibition complexes. Around the terminal area, more hotels, entertainment, shopping, meeting, and offices. As you go out, as you drive out from this urban core, you get the greater Aerotropolis, these corridors, spines, and clusters. Airport edge cities forming, 10 kilometers, up to 15 kilometers out. Major conference venues, trade and exhibition complexes, and showrooms will be locating, already have, near major airports. You need residential development. You can see this happening around Billy Bishop Airport. We certainly see it in a number of the other airports to house the workforce that has all the amenities, the urban amenities, as well as the accessibility airport. Aerotrain transport, light rail, people movers to connect the terminal and nearby commercial and accommodation nodes. But Pearson is looking now at how they're going to utilize this for the regional transport center. Aero lanes and aero trains, the Aerotropolis highway corridors and rail corridors to efficiently connect the airport to the downtown and other key nodes. Freight corridors connecting to the ports and other distant locations. The main corridor will be that connecting the airport to the central city. It'll be a corporate office and ICT corridor for office-oriented professional work. But it'll also house the range of functions that develop between the airport and the city, many of them headquarter office functions we see here in Mississauga. There'll be rail connections in down the center. This is going to develop for the Havelock Line going out to Pickering. All this needs to be integrated. The infrastructure, the residential, the commercial platforms need to be synergized and drive the development outward. And what separates the Aerotropolis and the airport city from the traditional metropolis and central city? Speedy national and global connectivity. The Aerotropolis is about speed and connectivity. Aviation routes are your 21st century physical internet to connect your communities and businesses quickly to their markets and customers. Everything you've seen in this video, and this is the wrap up, exists today. It's how you put it together, and are you going to have that opportunity to do that?
Okay. Just 3 minutes.
And what about the Toronto East Aerotropolis? Let me go back a little bit. I here list 10 reasons based on my study why I think it should succeed, certainly could. There's ample land specifically reserved for a major commercial airport, and that was the original intention, along with substantial adjacent land for economic development. Strategically located, if you look at the map of the GTA, it's actually very close to the center of the GTA. Excellent regional multimodal surface transportation connectivity to the airport site and surrounding areas. A transforming East Toronto economic base that is increasingly populated by aviation-oriented firms. A well-educated labor force who can staff the positions of these modern aviation-oriented industries. Local municipality leadership support. We have Mayor Ryan here. He was in a contest mayoral election last year with four candidates, he and three others. He got 62% of the vote. He was outwardly supportive of the airport. That reflects the community. They don't want the airport, they're not gonna elect Mayor Ryan. Broad industry support. A unique opportunity to plan, design, and operate a state-of-the-art airport. Airport City and Aerotropolis that's economically efficient, attractive, and sustainable. Expressed interest from major multinational firms to locate near the new airport, should it be constructed. Expressed interest from international airport investors to fund development of the airport and operate it at little or no cost to Transport Canada. But not everything is smooth. There is real and strong, articulate opposition. Led by land over landings. I understand we have some representatives here today, and I want to say I've been impressed with how effective you have been with your reports and media releases and other fundraising efforts. The land over landings believes that the airport should not be built and that the Pickering lands should be dedicated both in the short and the long term to sustainable agriculture. Among others, they provide two main reasons for their opposition, and I've looked at all of the reasons. The two main reasons are the airport's negative environmental impacts via greenhouse gas emissions and the loss of prime farmland in the region. Let's look at greenhouse gas emissions. This is the percentage from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is the benchmark on GHG, greenhouse gas emissions. Transportation, 14.4%. Aviation, 1.49%. I've seen studies that have taken it up to 2 or 2.5%, the impact of aviation. Greenhouse gas is not a local issue. Greenhouse gas is a global issue. And don't confuse the local with the global. Agriculture and forestry on the global issue, almost 25%. Aviation, about 2%. This has been documented time and time again. Again, on the local and global front, the addition of the Toronto East Airport would be basically infinitesimal in terms of greenhouse gas emissions compared to what is going on in aviation worldwide and the development of airports. Just look at China and the US as one example. In 2000, there were 62 million flights in China. You want to talk about greenhouse gas, you got to look at this globally. It's 1/10 of the US. In 2017, there were 551 million flights in China, 2/3 of the US. By 2037, there'll be 1.6 billion flights compared to 1.3 billion flights in the US, 300 million more flights in China. There are already 18,000 commercial airports operating worldwide. China's are going to double. The new airports adding on are bigger than Pearson, many of them. So the greenhouse gas effect, first of all, I have to understand, aviation contributes a very tiny percentage to greenhouse gas, under 2%, okay? Secondly, it's not gonna make a difference on greenhouse gas whether you build an airport at Pickering or not. It's gonna be so overwhelmed by the other growth of aviation. The loss of cropland issue. People think farmland's disappearing, cropland's disappearing. Cropland is actual farmland in use. Farmland includes forestry and forest and wetlands. Cropland is going up. Cropland's going up dramatically in Canada. But interestingly, cropland is going up in Ontario. It's going up in southern Ontario. They're actually adding to cropland here. It's not disappearing. It's adding. And then you'll see in a moment it's going up in Durham and the Durham region. These are the facts. This is the comparative land sizes in 2016 from the 2016 Census of Agriculture, regional cropland versus the Pickering lands. 3 million acres, 3.4 million acres. Between 2011 and 2016, the regional municipality of Durham added a net of 6,038 acres of cropland. That's about the equivalent to what is actually being farmed on the Pickering lands today. So if you took away the Pickering lands, your farmland's not going down. It's not going down. It's the growth of farmland, growth of cropland in southern Ontario is 15 times the size of the Pickering lands. It's growing 15 times faster. This is the data. And you have to separate data from ideology. So let me mention a few concluding points. A Toronto East Airport would not contribute negligibly to global greenhouse gas emissions. Aviation's a tiny percentage, and the growth of aviation nationally and worldwide is just going to be so much greater. It's spitting in the ocean. Increases in cropland in southern Ontario, these are increases, not size, the growth of southern Ontario croplands far overshadows the size of Pickering lands. There's plenty of cropland. There's plenty of crop. In many countries, they pay their farmers not to produce as price supports. If approved, the Toronto East Airport should not be planned and developed as a regional reliever airport. Richard will get into that. But it's originally intended by the federal government as Toronto's second major commercial airport, complementing and reinforcing Toronto Pearson and complementing the other airports in the SOAN region. A Toronto East Aerotropolis has the potential to substantially improve the competitiveness of the entire region's economy. And we're talking about competitiveness today, including its agriculture and food processing sectors. I'd love to have 15 minutes just to talk about the way I've watched these airports impact agriculture productivity and exports and the value of the of farming and actually attract more people into farming. It's not a zero-sum situation, airport versus agriculture. They work hand in hand together, particularly for the highest value agricultural products. You can move up that value chain as Landover Landings is proposing in its approach to the Pickering lands to move up that value chain of agricultural production. A successful Toronto East Aerotropolis can generate hundreds of thousands of jobs and billions of dollars of economic activity if properly developed. I thank you for your time.
Well, thanks, Mayor Ryan and the team. From Pickering for inviting me here, especially my good friend Fiaz, who I see there, who's kind of in the honcho of this. Thanks for bringing John Kasarda to Toronto. This is the second time John and I have physically met. We met once to talk about this event. He is the greatest scholar of airports and aerotropolis in the world. You heard about his bio. The book is remarkable. You need to read it. It really is a remarkable work. And not only that, he's probably one of a handful, if not less than a handful, of the world's leading urbanists and urban sociologists. He's really been an incredible influence and mentor to so many of us. And I'm honored to be able to work with him, learn from him, collaborate with him. I'm going to be brief because we want to have this conversation and really learning from one another. I just want to make two or three main points. First point is I was highly skeptical of John's arguments. So I went into this when I came to the U of T being very skeptical about the role of airports in economic competitiveness and economic development. And as a data-driven researcher with a big team of people, we wanted to take a look at this. And we built a pretty good database of all airports all over the world, and we did some pretty snazzy statistical analysis, and the results just knocked my proverbial socks off. That what John had been saying was true. It was more than true. The data backed his argument. that airports were one or two or three critical drivers of innovation, technological capability, global city status, economic competitiveness. The other two I knew a lot about. Having considerable clusters of technology-based industry, you know you've got to start to worry about Toronto when you turn on morning television, you turn on your morning, and Ben Mulrooney is a very good friend of mine, and you see Ben Mulrooney interviewing somebody talking about Toronto having 50% growth in IT capacity and being the largest growth in the tech sector in the world, and I'm like, holy, now we got to really be careful if I'm watching on in your morning. But we've done it. We've built this incredible cluster of technology and talent. The second one are great universities, and I was fortunate, you know, a dozen years ago to be attracted to the University of Toronto. You all know that we are the leading artificial intelligence center in the world. We have now levered that capability, and we're big. You know, Carnegie Mellon, where I taught, had 4,500 faculty members, 4,500 students, and about 450 faculty members. The University of Toronto has 90,000 plus students. We're big, and we have scale. We also built the world's first School of Cities, which is non-trivial, to bringing together computer scientists and artificial intelligence folks and urbanists. So tech talent, universities. But as important as those other two are airports. And increasingly, the ability to compete and win in the global economy turns on your ability to have airport connectivity. Local connectivity, connectivity to key markets in North America, like New York and Boston and DC and LA and Miami, and global connectivity. Those things really matter and are discriminating factors. John pointed this out. Increasingly, airports are critical not only for moving goods, but for moving people. If you want to be part of the global flow of information, of the global flow of knowledge, that just doesn't happen over the internet. That requires face-to-face interaction. That requires people coming together and meeting. And you can see this group of cities shrinking in real time, the places that are hubs of this kind of activity, like New York, like Los Angeles, like London, like Singapore, like Hong Kong, and like, hopefully, Toronto. The other thing that John talked about, which is really worth highlighting, which I didn't know much about, is airports not only do all of this highfalutin stuff in helping to lever economic development, they also are one of the few places that provide good, high-paying jobs for blue-collar workers. I'm going to New York tonight to go visit my hometown of Newark. Newark is probably one of the most devastated cities on the planet. My dad worked in a factory complex in the ironbound section. Where do you think Newark's blue-collar jobs are today? They're not in the ironbound section of Newark's manufacturing. They're around the Newark airport. Look at that complex John talked about out in Mississauga, a logistics complex, a complex of factory production. They are the airports and ports, nautical ports, are key providers of blue-collar jobs and then better service jobs. Airports traditionally have provided higher-paying, better service jobs. Airports are critical to our ability to connect to the world and the world's ideas. And as John mentioned, our region's growing size, you know, if you take the GTA, we're over 6 million people. If you take this mega region that stretches from Toronto and out to Kitchener and over to Ottawa and includes Buffalo and Rochester, we're at 12 million people. We're now at nearly 750 billion in economic output. That requires scale, and it's going to require more airport connectivity. And we know that Toronto's becoming, you know, my entire extended family lives in Michigan. My wife's family, and we're all going for a 50th birthday. Trust me, I'm well in excess of 50, so it's not mine. 50th birthday celebration. Everybody's flying through Toronto. Everybody from Michigan is flying through Toronto to go to Barcelona. And another thing I was very skeptical about, multiple airports add additional advantage. I've been working on this a little bit, and hopefully you'll hear from that in the future. Great large global cities don't just have one airport, they have multiple airports. My hometown, New York, metropolitan area, has roughly a half dozen airports, but it has three major, major airports. Washington, D.C. has two major airports, with Reagan National Airport in the U.S. Capitol almost right adjacent to the city itself. Miami, where we spent this winter, has two significant airports, Miami and Fort Lauderdale, literally juxtaposed to one another, and West Palm Beach not far off. I could go down the list. But multiple airports provide an additional advantage. Now, I just want to put this in context, and then we can talk. I'm worried about Toronto. I'm worried because we are becoming an anti-development community. No matter what is proposed now, there will be someone who says we can't do it. And why I'm worried? My home country, the United States, handed us an advantage. With the recent election and with the restrictions on immigration, it handed Toronto an incredible advantage. Great U.S. cities like New York are becoming incredibly expensive. San Francisco, John and I were just talking about that, a city we love where it's hard to build anything, where housing is remarkably more expensive than here. Seattle, which is becoming a difficult town to do business. I don't want Toronto to enter into those ranks, and I'm fearful it is becoming that. That everything we want to do, and a robust public dialogue is essential. But, you know, Jane Jacobs was a dear friend. A dear friend, and did so many great things. But she was a proponent of development. She was a proponent of market-based development. She was a proponent not of bad government planning, but of using the market to create well-being. And, you know, if we don't create jobs, and we don't grow businesses, and we don't globally connect, you think this way of life we have? We are in a globally competitive environment. I was just out in Tulsa, and our competition isn't just coming from big cities. I was just out in Tulsa, a remarkable city. You should go to these new, what they call the so-called rise of the rest cities. I lived in one, Pittsburgh, Detroit. Tulsa, a man named George Kaiser, made a lot of money, has spent a lot of money. He's the third largest philanthropic investor in the United States behind Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. And he said, you know what? If you don't want development in Toronto, you don't want development in New York, you don't want development in San Francisco, tell it to come here. And I told him, I'm stealing his phrase, come to the grateful cities. Come to the grateful cities, the cities like Pittsburgh, like Tulsa, like Milwaukee, that would be grateful for the investment you don't want. Well, look, I have to temper my worry, because we have done great things. We have grown technology jobs like gangbusters. We just completed a study of the world's leading technology startup ecosystems. We ranked 20th. 20, who would have thought that when I moved here, that Toronto would be the 20th largest startup ecosystem in the world? It's incredible. We are attracting talent and technology at a record pace. And according to my most recent ranking, composite ranking, we are the world's 10th leading global city. It's 7th leading global financial center. And as many people have shown us, we're the 3rd or 4th most livable city in the world. But we can't rest on our laurels. We got to double down on this. We can't get trapped by an anti-growth mentality. Look, and it's not just NIMBYism. I want to say this clearly and forthrightly. People say NIMBY, not in my backyard. What we're dealing with now in our cities is what I have termed the new urban Luddism. Do you remember who the Luddites were in England? They were the fellows and who were legitimately concerned that the machinery, the new machinery of the Industrial Revolution, was putting them out of work. So they took their tools and their hammers, and they smashed those machines. And as England, which was the world's leading industrial power, had to deal with all of that, the nature of competitive advantage shifted. It shifted right to North America. And the United States and Canada capitalized on that. But now it's not nations that are competing, it's cities that are competing. And Toronto isn't alone, even as the 10th largest global city. It is competing against bigger and smaller cities for a share of global investment, and to its credit, an incredible share of global talent. To make that move, we have to stop pointing fingers at one another, and we have to figure out ways to build airports, strengthen our global connectivity, build more rail and better transit, and build housing and all the other things we need. Thanks so much. An honor and privilege as you will be with you. Thank you.
Richard, as you pointed out, there's been more negativity now about development in this region. And there was just a wonderful op-ed today in one of our major newspapers from Jan De Silva talking about, why can't we build things? So as you've been looking at the value of airports and what they can contribute to a region, how do we get over that negativity? How do we help Toronto region not fall into the trap of not being able to build major important pieces for our economic infrastructure?
Well, I would say airports, along with universities, are the most important. I mean, it's really, John said it was railroads and it was canals and it was roadways. Now airports, the data are clear on this, on how important they are. And of course, we have to do it in a sustainable way. We have to do it in a green way. We have to do it in a way that does all of the things, that makes them, not more decent parts of our urban form. But I think, one, we have to have more of these frank conversations. We need folks like you and the Board of Trade to lead them. We have to engage people's concerns. I think people are rightly concerned that Toronto is, I wrote the book, Jan mentioned it, The New Urban Crisis. This is epicenter of, very expensive housing, growing inequality, fears of gentrification and displacement. So the only way we get around that is to build, though. And we have to make that case that as we build, we're going to do it in a way that begins to lift more boats. So I think it's a hard case to make, but now more than ever. And I actually think that Toronto's well positioned to make this case. I don't think, sometimes you want a little bit of dramatic effect. I don't think we're in the position of San Francisco or Seattle. I don't think we're that negative, but sometimes it seems like we're approaching that. So I think we've got to get our act together, we've got to stay steadfast, and we've got to, as you said, and Jan said, we've got to build.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. John?
Let me simply echo Richard, and we'll move on to the next question.
Okay, thank you very much. You've talked a lot about, Richard, you talk about the creative class. John, you talk about, high-end talent and how important this is for executive high-end talent. What about those that are not high-end talent? Mm-hmm. How does this impact them in the economy?
Well, Richard actually alluded to that in his remarks, and I'll put an exclamation point on it. The research that we did at UNC showed that the working class actually benefits at least as much, if not more. For every Toronto investment banker that jets to London to go to Canary Wharf or wherever, there's a limo driver, taxi driver, there are baggage handlers, there are hotel maids and laundry staff and restaurant workers. Products that move between the airports are driven by truck drivers, often the factories or distribution centers. So our research has shown that the majority of jobs that are connected are actually working class jobs. Yes, it does support investment bankers and corporate lawyers and the business community in general, but it has amazing inclusiveness, economic inclusiveness in terms of overall impact. And Richard, you made a point that actually came out in our research with a colleague of yours a number of years ago, Steve Apple.
Yep.
We found that the wages were actually higher of the blue collar workers that were tied in with industry-linked work, as well as the white collar. So it's just not wealthy business travelers and elite leisure travelers. It's economically inclusive. Workers up and down the social economic ladder benefit in the Aerotropolis.
Yeah, I want to make this point at two levels. First, if you don't have global airport connectivity, and you don't have your airport close and airports close and easy to get to, you will not get the kind of global investment that increasingly location decisions of corporations and headquarters are made with access to global gateway airport connectivity, and the location decisions of remote workers, of which there are many, many more. One of the reasons South Florida is developing it with not much of an industrial base is because people get on planes and commute. And they're called so-called super commuters. Just in my own, I flew into Pearson last night. I'm going to fly out to Newark on Island Airport. And I think John and I were talking about this. What we're finding now is that people are paying for proximity. They want to live closer to air. It sounds so crazy because for years we were, oh, they're noxious and they're noisy. Now people are paying to live closer to airports. And I do think we can make airports a better part of the urban fabric and more sustainable. That's what we're going to work on. But the other thing, as John said, is they're really important creators of good, high-paying jobs for the not-so-skilled. Both the heavy lifting jobs, but also those service jobs. You know, if you're a service worker working in an airport, HMS host of Starbucks, you're making more money than the equivalent worker in another shop. So it's really interesting that airports tend to benefit both directly and indirectly blue collar and service workers.
Yeah. If I might add quickly, I mentioned that time is not just cost, it's also currency. What is critical in connectivity is the total travel time.
Yeah.
And one of the challenges that's faced here is when I try to get a flight out of Pearson, 4 or 5 months ago, leaving at 7:30 in the morning, I was told you have to leave 2.5 hours.
For sure.
2.5 hours, because it's going to take you 90 minutes.
For sure.
To get to the airport. Again, the Aerotropolis is about optimizing time locally as well as nationally and globally. And the real challenge that I see here, looking at these roadways coming into Pearson and some of the other airports, it's total transit time. I was talking to the director of Billy Bishop Airport. He said something amazing, and I have to write about this. He said 41% of our flyers walk to the air.
Yeah.
And that's absolutely amazing, but that's an idea. And this is what we're seeing. The wealthiest community in the United States, ranked by Forbes a number of years ago, South Lake, Texas. It's a suburb of Dallas. It is 300 yards from the outer runway of Dallas-Fort Worth Airport. As Richard said, people used to avoid airports in terms of residence, but now with them being increasingly important, dual-income families where one spouse works in locally and one works in another city, yep. We're finding them gravitating to these airport areas, and it's rather amazing. Mm. Jen?
No. One of the things that, and again, you touched on it, is taking land that some people are looking at saying, wait a minute, this is agriculture land, or this is greenbelt land, or conservation land, or whatever. And some arguments have been made that there's more economic value in having the land support agriculture rather than supporting an airport. So, John, you've touched on that a little bit.
Yes, and there have been studies that have done. Land Over Landings did a major economic impact study a couple years ago, and I won't go into the details out or comment on its quality, but as far as I could tell, it was professionally done. But its fatal flaw is because it concluded that the Pickering lands are best served, the region's best served by maintaining them as agriculture. That report is confused theory of absolute advantage with theory of comparative advantage. And in economics. And absolute advantage, they showed very nicely, up to 450 jobs on the site, and total productivity going, revenues going from 3.7 million to 30 million taxes. But compared to what? What if there was an airport city there? You're talking billions of dollars and tens of thousands of jobs. So while that might be a fine report, in terms of what agriculture will contribute. Certainly the underlying argument of food security is just, in my judgment, off the mark. There's no food security promise, basically due to income levels, the food problem, poverty, and distribution. When you rank countries on food security, the top ranked country is the most secure, doesn't have any agriculture, it's Singapore. And so they do it by wealth and by connectivity. Mm-hmm. So the Pickering lands isn't going to solve the world's food security issue. Primarily, the world's food security issue is one of income and one of logistics, of mm-hmm. distributing it. And that's the problem we see even in Canada, where it's up in the north. And it's a problem of getting the products there and the income levels of the people. So to me, the agricultural value argument is a very good in an absolute sense. But what you need to look at is there a better There are going to be greater returns. Secondly, it's not a zero-sum situation. All the work that I have seen has shown that airports actually boost agricultural productivity, boost the value of the exports, enable farmers to move up the value chain, what they produce, by generating products not only that are consumed locally, but are demanded nationally and globally, and they can get those products there quickly and efficiently via air. Entire agricultural economies at the high end, like in Thailand where I work, with fresh fish and fresh cut flowers, orchids, and so on. It's all tied to aviation. The farmers that are in that sector make a lot more money than those growing rice utilize aviation. So it's not a zero-sum situation. Many airports, like in South Africa, they put the production facilities right on the airport property. So it is not agriculture versus aviation. Aviation can actually boost the value of agricultural productivity throughout Southern Ontario.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We have some folks with microphones who are going to be wandering around the room. Now, I can't see out in the audience very well because of these lights. There's somebody already? Yeah?
No, I can see her with the microphone.
Oh, there, with the microphone. Okay, so we've got a few minutes for some questions from the audience. So actually, we have one right here, right up at the front, actually. So if the microphone can run up here fast. We have a question here right at the front of the room.
John, my name is John Koch. I heard your analysis about greenhouse gases, and I just wondered that if the flight happened anyways, but happened somewhere different. So instead of driving to Toronto East Airport, we drove to Kitchener, or we drove to Hamilton, or we drove to Peterborough, or we drove in congested traffic to Pearson. The flight's the same. I would have thought greenhouse gases were worse and not slightly better.
That's a very interesting point, because remember I said 90 minutes from Pickering to get this. What do you think is coming from those exhaust fumes? Gases. Okay, all those traffic jams, the ability to, because it's being clogged up on the land side coming into it, you actually are adding to greenhouse gases by not having a Pickering airport, traveling to other airports. So it's the total transit time, it's how energy is used in total. But greenhouse gases, the majority of them are road traffic of the transportation component. So. If you're looking at just on a local level, I prefer your greenhouse gas really as a macro global issue. But even on a local issue, if you're stuck in traffic, you are generating greenhouse gases, and that having an airport, the East is not well served. If you look at the SOAN network, pretty good. You know, if you look at Waterloo the cargo air, the Hamilton, excellent Air Express airport and cargo airport, and on out. The West is pretty well served, but the East is not, and that's in the corridor of growth. And not being served, you are probably generating as much greenhouse gases. I wish I could get that documented, but I recall reading a study about 15 years ago that said most of the emissions come from cars and trucks around the airport, not from the aircraft themselves. I don't have that citation right now, but I remember reading it. But to your point, that not having an airport in the East, people driving in congested traffic, is going to do two things. One, it's going to add substantially to the greenhouse gases. Okay. Secondly, it's going to affect the quality of life of the non-airport commuters who live and commute in that area with those highways clogged up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I think that's one of the things in Durham Region, and I think the video I touched on it earlier at the beginning, is that there are whole neighborhoods being built in that region, and people would prefer to not have to drive an hour or 90 minutes or whatever, or even to take the GO train, excellent as it is, Phil. Mm-hmm. To get to their job. They want to have more time, more personal time. So it's a really, really important point. Anybody else from the audience here that wants to? There's one right over there.
Hello, my name is David Masters. My question is, aren't we in danger of overbuilding infrastructure? We know what's happened previously in Canada with Montreal and Mirabel. Clearly, the GTAA master plan stated that they have plenty of capacity for the next 20 years. And in terms of the Southern Ontario Airport Network, they have enough capacity for 30 years. Their ground lease states that there should not be any competition from an international coast-to-coast airport or even an interprovincial airport within 75 kilometers of that airport, and that ground lease applies to 2050. So how can you justify building another airport when high-speed trains don't even exist in this country?
Okay. Go ahead, John.
We've done a lot of work on high-speed trains, and there is some substitution effect up to about 500 kilometers. Beyond that, it drops off dramatically, and high-speed trains might be fine for landed areas, but they don't go well across water and certainly aren't intercontinental. And I also looked at, because this is a real issue, it bothered me, the disaster that you mentioned early on at Mirabel. And it was a disaster for multiple reasons. First of all, it was built so far out, and they promised all these roads and rail. Rail was to be the, never happened, okay? Then they made an amazing mistake of saying all the domestic traffic will be in one airport, Duval, whatever have, mm-hmm. and the international will be, well, how do international flights fill up? They fill up by transfers, you know, from the domestic. Then they got into the Quebec issue, and the corporations started bailing out, going to places like Toronto, and they lost a good part of their economic base. So it was a disaster on so many fronts that just need not be avoided. In terms of the regulations of the 75 miles, if that's a law, laws, when they can be appropriately and should appropriately be amended, can and should be amended.
Well, and I think you're seeing much more business and growth in Durham region than you did around Mirabel. So I don't think that's as big a threat, certainly in our region.
Yeah, but it was such a mistake.
Yeah. Oh, it was very much so. I think who else has got the microphone? We've got someone, yes? Someone who I know we will all recognize.
Hazel McCallion, the former mayor of the city of Mississauga.
Yeah.
Now a member of the airport board, the director. I want to assure you that what you two gentlemen said about an airport, we would never have taken a rural community like Mississauga to the sixth largest city in Canada with an economic relationship between industry, commerce, and residential, 60-40 industrial and commercial. So we would have never done it without the Pearson Airport. Yes, and so I say to you, an airport is a great asset to any city, especially the creation of jobs, but also the economic base. We have 102 Japanese companies in our city. We have 86 German companies, and it just goes on and on. The airport did it.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much. And also, for those of you who missed this month's Zoomer magazine, the former mayor is the cover girl on the front. One more question from someone right there behind. Get a microphone. Actually, you may be faster if you go to the microphone than if the microphone comes to you.
She's moving.
Hi, I'm Hans Battle with Federbial Airports. Thank you both for the extremely interesting presentation. A question for Dr. Kasarda. If you could mention, you mentioned your in your Aerotropolis presentation that the features that you highlighted were an amalgamation of a number of different example Aerotropolises, and I was keen to know if you could just mention a few of the cornerstone airports that served as examples specifically in that. And then as a second part of the same question, if you could mention any that come to your mind, examples of cities that have a dual airport structure that you think would be a unique precedent for the particular project that is being considered here.
Yeah. Okay, and I'll be fast because I spent a lot of time on examples. From the international standpoint, it's mostly because they've been driving this process for decades, some of the largest airports. Amsterdam Schiphol is the granddaddy of the airport city, and Aerotropolis. It's just done a phenomenal job. But a newer airport that has done extremely well, both the airport city and the greater Aerotropolis, spinning off outlying cities, is Incheon, South Korea airport. It is a true model of an airport city and Aerotropolis, including developing the greenest, smartest city that many believe exists today, that actually succeeded, and that's New Songdo City, sometimes referred to as Songdo International Business District. It's not perfect, but they have implemented green development, connectivity, and all the factors that Richard talks about in an amazing way as a airport edge city. There have been somewhere, I try to look at those where you have a brand new airport or second airport. I don't know if Jeff Fagan is here. He's on the board at Pickering, but I looked at Fort Worth Alliance Airport in Fort Worth. It's a brand new airport. Began in the early 1990s. It's been incredibly successful, but primarily because of the FedEx hub and the real estate development of Hillwood. But they have generated $40 or $50 billion of economic activity on and around the lands as really a second airport. As you move around the world, Belo Horizonte in Brazil has done a very good job. In Africa, Durban and Johannesburg are developing nicely the Aerotropolis concept. There are many, many examples. In the U.S., Atlanta, Detroit, Memphis, Denver. One could go on, Denver being a relatively new airport, 1995. But these are major airports. Pickering will not be a major airport out of the gates, but it has all the potential to develop. And what's nice, what's great for Pearson and the other airports, it's going to grow when you need it to grow. It's not going to come in with 20 million passengers next year. This is going to be a process. It'll take 10 or 15 years to get the airport operating just when you absolutely need it. And it can be a major airport city and Aerotropolis. And the timing is right, because by the time you get through all the environmentals and all the other issues that need to be done, you're honestly talking 10 to 15 years, and you're right in the period when this region needs a second major airport. And why don't you talk about size and scale and activity, and why it needs to be a large airport?
Yeah, I'll be really brief, but I just want to build on what you said and the comment about, are we building too much infrastructure? If you think about the growth trajectory of this region, 100,000 plus people a year, you think about the fact that half of those people come from other countries. And we're at 6 million plus. The mega region's at 12 million plus. We are going to be bursting at the seams. And if, you know, I go back to the New York of my youth and my father's youth, New York was planning its transit systems, its airport systems back at the turn of the last century, thinking about what do we need to grow to be a metropolitan area of 10 million, 15 million, 20 million. Well, Toronto, the GTA, like it or not, is going to be at that scale. Pearson is a spectacular, you call it a global super hub, and what Mayor Hazel said about leveraging and building up Mississauga as one of the biggest cities in Canada, an economic engine. We have a terrific urban Aerotropolis right here in the downtown that gives you connectivity to New York and Boston and Ottawa, and it's unbelievable. And the idea is, how can we make them more sustainable, more integrated? And out east, then you think about the third part of this triangle, not only for new capacity, international and domestic, creating that scale that's gonna have to go somewhere, that air capacity, but now you've got an anchor for development. out east. Mm-hmm. The same way that the mayor said about what happened in Mississauga can help happen out east. So, but I do think we need to think about these things strategically. We need to take those infrastructure investments seriously. We need to do it in a way that's state of the art, that is sustainable and integrated into what we do. But look, if we don't plan for the growth is going to come at us as it has, and we're going to end up reacting. So I think it's time, and Jen, credit to you, it's time that we really think that we have to build and plan for the growth we need.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. And I think it is indeed not only time for an airport, but time to end our session today. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Over to you, Jen. Thanks.
Okay. Nicely done.
So this is one of those events that I know we'll be talking about for a long time, at dinner tables, at lunch tables, sitting in the car on the phone, possibly, as we're driving back to our offices. Thank you, Richard and John. And Janet, it's always great to see you leading an insightful discussion like this. I started by talking about the fact, or reflecting on the fact, that we're the third largest commercial center in North America. And one of the reasons why all of our boards of trade are working so closely together is, here's the thing. We share many of the same members. Many of the same companies are members across the whole, and they're looking for us to solve pain points. I would tell you that right now, the number one pain point I'm hearing from our members, be them foreign direct investing international companies or domestic companies, is our inability over time to plan for and build the capacity we need. It's not about waiting until it happens and then trying to play catch up, because quite frankly, folks, that's why it's taking 90 minutes to get from Pearson to the airport. I also spoke about we're having a moment. Well, if we want momentum, it's time to start future-proofing our economy, which will mean we'll be able to future-proof our households and our workforce. And it's all about, how do we start thinking now about capacity we're going to need, capacity we need to create. The board sees aviation and airports as key pillars for the multimodal movement of people and goods. We need to connect inputs to manufacturing, goods to market, workers to their jobs. And what's being talked about today on a big, well-planned, thoughtful scale about a holistic approach to opening up and supercharging the eastern part of our economic zone is truly inspiring, and it's something I hope we can really work together to get across the finish line. It's one part of our very important economic zone. It's not the only part, but it clearly is a compelling thing that we need to take some action on. Let me just close by just reflecting on a couple of things that you may want to look forward to as we continue this conversation. On May 27th, the Southern Ontario Airports Network is holding an event, a good place to continue the dialogue. It's not about one size fits all, it's about having capacity across the economic zone. As well, the board on April 17th is holding a power breakfast with the CEOs of OPG and Bruce Power to have an in-depth conversation on both leadership style and the future of energy in our province. And let me tell you, as we're talking about transit and capacity building, our ability to provide smart technology and smart energy sources is critical. And on May 1st, we'll welcome Ontario Minister of Transportation, the Honourable Jeff Urich, for a keynote at our podium. I anticipate it'll be transit-oriented, so it might be a good event to attend. So to learn more about this and other events, please visit us at bot.com/events. Mayor Ryan, thank you so much. You really led the charge on a very invigorating discussion today. Lots to reflect on as we leave the room. Have a great afternoon. Take your desserts with you as you go. Thank you.